I'm very pleased to take part to this prestigious Matisse meeting where several of my colleagues and friends are present. And I would like to warmly thank the Barnes Foundation and in particular Sylvie Patry for their invitation. As Sylvie asked me today, I will not present my current research on Matisse, but rather an exhibition I curated from the NAM collection and which within this specific framework seems to me to open up different lines of thought and possibly future research. Matisse in his time, an exhibition conceived exclusively from the Musée National d'Art Moderne Centre Georges Pompidou collection, take place in Switzerland at the Giannada Foundation in Martigny in Italy, in Turin, and in the United States at Oklahoma City, where it has just closed at the end of September. As the title indicates, it presented the work of Matisse in dialogue with those of his peers from the beginning of the 20th century to the 50s. The figure of Matisse dominated mid-20th century art. A prolific, curious, and social artist throughout his career, he was at the very heart of the debates that were taking place on the artistic scene. During his lifetime, he was a leader of the Fauve, a critical observer of Cubism, a student of and friend of to his predecessors, Signac, Renoir, Mayol, Bonnard, the teacher of an academy and a whole generation of European expressionists, Picasso's rival, the pioneer of abstract art for the younger generation of artists, in particular for New York's abstract expressionists and for the members of the support surface movement in France. The bulk of the artist correspondence preserved at the archives Henri Matisse in France and gradually published over time clearly reveals how Matisse's social world and his friendships were essentially related to art. The letters he received or sent were written by or for his many artist friends, especially Bonnard and his youthful companions, Camoin, Marquet, Rouault, Derain, his patrons, publishers, art dealers, some museum directors and conservators. Although Matisse shied away from political life, he did work hard to come to the head, either through petitions or by actual funding of artists like Gris, Mayol and Laurence. In spite of the comparison with Picasso that is routinely made when discussing Matisse's art, the creator of dance is often perceived and introduced as a singular, unique, and isolated force, like a master whose influence seems rather evident. This image quickly took shape, starting from Matisse's first public exhibitions at the turn of the century, and it is clearly illustrated in the words of Picasso's companion, Fernand Olivier. I quote, "Matisse was much older than Picasso and a serious and cautious man. He never saw eye to eye with the younger painter. As different from the North Pole is from the South Pole," he would say, when talking about the two of them. There was something very nice about Matisse. With his regular features and his thick golden beard, he really looked like a grand old man of art. He seemed to be hiding through behind his thick spectacles, and his expression was opaque, giving nothing away, though he always talked for ages as soon as the conversation moved on to painting. He would argue, assert, and endeavor to persuade. He was already 45 and very much his own master. Unlike Picasso, who was usually rather sullen and inhibited in occasions like the Steins Saturdays, Matisse shone and impressed people. They were the two painters of whom the most was expected. Matisse began to paint late in his life, but when he did, he already appeared to be mature, and the ideas he developed about art made him a leader among his fellow disciples in the studios. From the time of his debut in the studio of Gustave Moreau, Matisse was looked upon as an intellectual and artistic authority. The radical force of his painting, the surprising novelty of his work at the start of the 30s, and to a certain extent, the important place he filled together with very few others, such as Picasso and Braque, in the development of an ideology of modern French art starting from the First World War, justify the exceptional aura surrounding him that clearly isolated him from the rest of the artistic context, which was nonetheless his own. Starting from the large collection of works of the Musée National d'Art Moderne, we have chosen to penetrate this ivory tower by showing Matisse's work from the point of view of his friendships and his artistic exchanges with other artists. By drawing visual comparisons with the work of some of his contemporaries, we can visualize the subtle reciprocal influences, their common source, and also a sort of spirit of the times that joins Matisse and others and involves periods that had been overlooked until now, such as the modernism of the 40s and 50s. Undoubtedly, there is a similar formal expression in the works of Léger, Dufy, Le Corbusier, Matisse, or even Picasso that cannot be reduced to certain stylistic features, such as a palette of primary colors, monumental and decorative stylization of the drawing, the humanist iconography, and that especially resonates in the broader political and cultural context. This exhibition examined Matisse's artistic career and was arranged into 9 chronological sections divided by specific themes. The eminently Matissean figures of the Odalisque, for example, but also the portrayal of the studio, a recurring theme in Matisse's work, which in the gloomy years of the Second World War led to the outstanding paintings signed by Braque, Picasso, or Bonnard, and engaged an invisible dialogue with the artist who was isolated in Vence. The 9 sections, the Moreau's Fauvism, Matisse and Cubism, the Nice years, the painter of Odalisque, Matisse and Surrealism, painting, the painting Matisse Studio, Modernism, the turnaround in the 30s, Matisse's legacy to abstract art, the final years, enable us to follow Matisse's trajectory together from his debut to the studio of Gustave Moreau in 1897 to 1999, until his death when other artists in the 60s were inspired by the color paper cut he created in his final years. The exhibition begins with Matisse's debut and the unswerving friendships he developed with his fellow students in Gustave Moreau's studio at the École des Beaux-Arts. Albert Marquet, Charles Camoin, Henri Manguin, together, they made a series of paintings on the same subjects, coffee pots, views of the scene from the studio, models in the studio itself, and spent sessions copying paintings at the Louvre. All of them united by the lessons taught in Paris' most liberal studio at the time. A period spent in Midi Collioure in the summer of 1905 marked the start of the adventure of the Fauve under Matisse's patronage. The scandal that arose from the exhibition of paintings featuring pure colors created by Matisse and his friends Manguin, Camoin, and Marquet, and by André Derain and Maurice de Vlaminck at the Salon d'Automne in 1905, marked the birth of the movement known as Fauvism, which was also embraced the following year by the younger artists Braque and Dufy. Matisse, who was fervently against Braque's choice of Cubism in 1908 and his friendship with Picasso, would nonetheless admit many years later that Cubism comes, I quote, Cubism's Cubism comes from Cézanne, who said that everything in either a cylinder or a cube. That was a time when we didn't feel restrained by uniforms, boldness and innovation where we discovered in the painting of a friend belonged to everybody. In September 1914, not having been drafted into the army, Matisse left for Collioure and found Juan Gris there waiting for him. The paintings he made at the time were strongly marked by the ideas that Picasso, Braque, and Gris at first began to develop in 1909-1910. Matisse painted windows, a recurring theme in his work, as well as portraits. The nearly abstract canvas French window Collioure, which might at the first sight appear to be unfinished, is a composition made using broad swaths of black and blue color along the lines of Gris' work. At the same time, the stylization of the figures that Matisse realized in the series of sculptures, the back or in the large-scale painting Bathers by a River, clearly echoes the research conducted by Henri Laurence. After the excitement of the Parisian years, in 1917, Matisse finally settled in Nice, offering himself a new start in that region with its temperate climate. He met Auguste Renoir, often visited Mayol's studio, and reconnected with his friend Pierre Bonnard. Thanks to the École des Beaux-Arts in Nice, he became acquainted with new models, with new models such as the Italian Lorette. His portraits and intimist compositions of figures multiplied, and once again Matisse drew inspiration from his earliest sources, that is Impressionism, with an analysis of Renoir and Monet late paintings. Through his dialogue with his predecessors, Matisse participated in his own way in the return of classicism of the 20s on a part with Durand and Picasso. At the same time, inspired by his stays in Morocco, as well as by the work of Delacroix, Matisse reinvented the exotic theme of the odalisque. In his own words, I quote, "As for the odalisque, I had seen them in Morocco, and this enabled me to add them to my paintings without having to imagine what they looked like once I had got back to France." His models were colorful, oriental-like clothes. The setting were filled with accessories, flowers, and fabrics that created a luxuriant and lustful atmosphere. The density of the ornamentation and the color is what characterized the artist's painting in that period, something that would remain emblematic of Matisse's hedonist and refined art for a long time. It was both a commercial success and an outright fashion. A modern orientalist current took shape around Matisse's odalisque, also thanks to the mediation of Roger Besombe. Picasso himself, after Matisse's death, would confide, "When Matisse died, he left his odalisque to me as his legacy, and this is my idea of the Orient, though I have never been there." End of the quote. Matisse considered his drawing to be a very intimate means of expression. He often made drawings to inform his paintings and sculptures, feeling that these drawings should be quick gestural exercise that captures the form and emotion evoked in him by the subject. In the early 40s, he conceived his famous sequence of thème et variation, sensitively drawn spare works in elegant and shaded line, describing simplified forms of female figures or still lifes that he executed almost automatically, his hand feeling its way intuitively across the page. The spontaneity of these drawings and the dreamy atmosphere of his work, Le Rêve, can be associated with surrealism, with surrealist automatic drawing and the wistful contemplative works from the same period by artists such as Picasso, Masson or Miro, who were represented by his son Pierre Matisse in his gallery. In Midi, Matisse once again found Renoir, Mayol, Bonnard, with whom he shared the same idea of color that was used to produce intimist work, interiors, still life portraits transfigured by the golden light of the south. I quote, "I live my life surrounded by the walls of my studio," he told his son Pierre. The 40s were the season of the master return, of the master's return to painting and of his interiors in Vence. Matisse again put the window motif at the heart of his work. The representation of the studio was a recurring theme among many artists at that time: Picasso, Braque, Dufy, and Giacometti. It was a reflexive and self-referential image of painting, which combined the artist's trade, a private space, a place where one could focus despite the madness of the world, and lastly, a mental space. Upon the outbreak of the Second World War, the great figurative artists Matisse, Léger, Picasso, Dufy changed their style. It became looser, more schematic, and there was a preference for a palette of primary colors that echoed the modernist language of the Le Corbusier and of Mondrian. The paintings Matisse produced after the large-scale decoration for the Barnes Foundation revealed the artist's discovery of a new formal economy, and today this clearly seems to have been related to the aesthetics of the 50s. Starting in 47, Matisse invented a new technique, gouache on paper cutouts, which allowed him to cut directly into color. He explained, I quote, "Rather than drawing the outline and putting color there, one modifying the other, I draw directly in color, which is even more measured in that it is not composed. This simplification guarantees a precision in the union and the two methods to make one." The new methods originated by Matisse would end up having a great impact on the work of the artist in the following generation. The abstract expressionists like Roscoe, Sam Francis, or Shirley Jaffe, the member of the support surface group like Vincent Bulès, Claude Viala, or Jean-Pierre Pincemain, but also Simon Antaille and many others. Thanks to the dissemination of his work in the United States through his son Pierre, the exhibitions of his work in France when he was already a mature artist, and the decorative and architectural complex of Vence Chapel, Matisse's work fueled the heart of both the 20th century. The catalogue comprises a vast anthology of extracts from letters, statements, and recollections by Matisse, as well as by other artists. This section is sorted by name, and a collection of this kind of in Matisse studies has never been seen before and will no doubt prove to be very useful. Reading these exchanges enriches and enlivens or knowledge of this network of long-term friendships. In some cases, the correspondence covers more than 40 years, and thus points out the variations and evolutions that took place over the course of time. Matisse's writing still is very clear. He expresses his opinions on art perspicuously, and some of his letters, especially the ones he wrote to Bonnard and to Rouault are so reflexive and sensitive, they have the quality of few felt treaties. Others, more intimate and familiar, which he wrote to his old friends, to Marquet or to Camoens, reveal a light-hearted Matisse and sometimes a more cantankerous one, allowing us to glimpse inside the everyday lives of these artists. Most of the extracts collected here have already been published, while a few of them were taken directly from the archives Henri Matisse. But what is especially interesting about this anthology lies in their collection, in the overall view divided into three parts that is afforded to the reader, arcing back to the idea of Matisse in his time. Matisse and his contemporaries, Matisse and his predecessors, Matisse and his successors. This exhibition, which presented a radical overview of modern art in Paris from the first half of the 20th century, allowed a series of stimulating visual and sometimes inhabitual confrontations, and I believe opened new directions to be explored, such as the modernism of the 40s and 50s, or Matisse's relationship with surrealism and automatic writing. I would like to develop this further here as a conclusion in order to highlight the different possible and perhaps unexpected threads of this question. In the early 30s, the radical change that took place in Matisse's work was clearly expressed in both the project of the dance commissioned by Albert Barnes and the artist illustration for Mallarmé Poésie. In the later work, the drawing served as a counterpoint to the text while at the same time remaining independent of it. I quote, "The book needn't be completed with an illustration imitating the contents. The painter and the writer must work in parallel without mixing up their roles. The drawing has to be a graphic equivalent of the poem." These reflections on the line, its fluidity and its independence, could also be seen in Matisse's painting. The color was applied in light hued backgrounds and lived by the sinuous lines of the drawing that was no longer used to delineate, but rather perform a score of its own, like a dance step around the color. In a letter to Bonnard, the painter expressed his concern with regard to his difficult search for harmony. I quote, On the one hand, my drawing suits me as it expresses the peculiarity of what I feel. My painting instead is trapped by my new practice of using backgrounds through which I must express myself fully, backgrounds filled with one color and devoid of shading of shapes which must interact with each other to be able to suggest the light, the spiritual space. Thus were born several of the artist's masterpieces, including Large Reclining Nude, the Pink Nude, the 24 photographs that document the gestation phase of this work shows the gradual stylization of the figure that little by little reached up as far as the frame of the painting according to a decorative trend that can also be seen in Music of 1938 and subsequently in the upper portion of the fireplace made for the Rockefeller apartment in New York in 1939. The refined blue and pink harmony, the subject, the linear and stylized drawing of the figure, which is oversized hands in Dream, 1935, exhibit an oniric quality that was greatly appreciated at the time. The dream theme and the automatism of the drawing or of writing, closely analyzed by the surrealists during the early 20s, especially in Breton and Soupault, the magnetic fields of 19, and in the Surrealist Manifesto, 1924, would in a very short time become the patrimony of all the modern artistic expressions. Although Matisse, unlike Picasso, never followed the Surrealist closely, his pictorial and graphic work was praised by Breton, who persuaded Jacques Doucet to add to his collection, along with Picasso's Demoiselle d'Avignon, Matisse's Goldfish. Some art journals published by Surrealist circles devoted world issues to Matisse. In 1936, Cahiers d'Art published his most recent drawings accompanied by a text by Christian Zervos with the emblematic title Automatisme et Espace Illusoire, and by a poem by Tristan Tzara entitled E Matisse. Albert Skira, who had commissioned Matisse to illustrate Mallarmé's poesie, dealt with the artist's work in one of the issues of his elegant journal Minotaur. The journal's mission was to reconcile the two sides of surrealism represented by Breton and Bataille, respectively. Matisse designed the cover of issue number 9, published in October 1936. There is indeed a certain stylistic affinity between the modernist notebooks produced in the 30s. The paintings made by André Masson between 1924 and 1929, during the time when he embraced Breton surrealism, the automatic drawings, the sand paintings, but also Les Soupiraux of 1924, stem from the same reflection on the organic nature of the line and on the continuity of the figure and the space in which it is inscribed. Masson was fascinated by Matisse's drawings and often visited the artist while he was working on Mallarmé's poesie in 1932. Masson stressed the role of music in Matisse's life. I quote, "After lunch, before taking a nap, he plays a record on the gramophone, Schumann's Arabesque, a delightful piece of lace work that makes one feel like drawing." Masson also noted that Matisse's observations on dance were the equivalent of the sign traced on paper and strangely in resonance with his own paintings. I quote again, "The genius of dance starts from the farthest part of the foot and arrives at the tip of the hand. The hand, its drawing in space, will be clear cut and devoid of stiffness. The hand is the point of arrival of the energy that pervades the entire body. The point is itself, in itself, is nothing other than routine." John Miró, a friend of Masson, proclaimed by Breton a surrealist artist par excellence, analyzed Matisse's painting. Miró's painting, 1927, a vibrant blue monochrome enlivened by form painted in flat colors and by linear organic signs that appear to fluctuate, was openly inspired by works like Dance and the Dinner Table of 1910. But it can mostly be traced back to the poetic and dreamlike atmosphere of the early 30s. The work heralded the large-scale triptych blue of 1961. Miró met Matisse after the Second World War, thanks to his agent in New York, Pierre Matisse, who was the first to exhibit the almost abstract composition French Window at Collioure. When Matisse began to make dance, Fernand Léger, whose monumental modernism sensitive to social issues seemed to be a far cry from his fellow artist aesthetics, toned down his own figuration. Around 1930, the two artists, both intrigued by the world of the circus, acrobats, and cinema, found separate solutions that to a certain extent also converged to the problem of the dynamism of the line and the composition. It was through the practice of cinema that the 1924 Ballet Mécanique that Léger recuperated a freedom of composition that, on the occasion of the conference of the Museum of Modern Art in New York in 1935, he described as follows. Once the subject had been destroyed, we needed to find something else. The object and pure color take on the role of values that compensate. In the new phase, the freedom of composition becomes infinite. There is total freedom permitting composition from the imagination in which creative fantasy can emerge and develop. Léger thus produced a series of canvases among with Gioconda with Keys of 1930, where the figures and objects suspended inside the color fields reveal surrealist nuance. Léger's fluctuating and stylized Blue Dancer of 1930, which underscored the contrast between fragile, evocative drawing and illusionistic industrial architectural form, was likely a nod to Matisse. While in Nice, Matisse continued to explore drawing in an ambitious project whose development was witnessed by Aragon during the war years. From every point of view, Matisse was badly traumatized by the war, and he would later describe the post-war years as a second life. An extra lease on life allowed to someone who had been resuscitated. The separation from his wife, Amélie, finalized by their divorce in March 1939, the difficulty he had getting from Paris to Nice, traveling, and lastly, the stomach surgery he underwent in Lyon in January 1941, which he survived against all odds, but which left him weakened, and all events that made this troubled and depressing period of isolation even worse. Forced to spend much of the day in bed, Matisse devoted his time to drawing in order to accomplish a sort of completeness. I quote, "For a year, I have made a very considerable effort. I had perfected my drawing, and it is like a blossoming after 50 years. I must do the same for painting." Matisse, alone in his room, immobilized, focused on the discipline of drawing, investigating the concepts of virtuosity and spontaneity, the automatic and controlled flow of the line, the relationship with the model and with the space of the sheet. To document his own thoughts, he began working on an ambitious album project whose systematic nature was worthy of a conceptual work. Thème et Variation is a collection of 158 drawings divided into 17 series, in which Matisse compared drawings with charcoal shading, the theme, with line drawings, the variations. I quote, "They are made up of a series of which the initial drawing for each series is a charcoal study giving way to a series of pen or pencil drawings emerging like perfumes from the original. By means of this profusion of drawings featuring vivid, concise lines, Matisse tried to emphasize the importance of the gesture in what could be defined as an inspired drawing, one that is made unconsciously endowed with a spiritual dimension. He gave Aragon a detailed explanation of the process. I quote, "When I make my variation, the root of my pencil on the sheet of paper is in some respects analogous to the gesture of a man groping in the darkness. What I mean to say is that there is nothing planned about this root. I'm led, I do not lead. In reproducing the model, I go from one point to the object to another, considering each point separately, independent of those two words which my pen will then be directed. I'm guided only by an inner drive that I translate as it is formed, rather than by the exterior appearance of the point on which I focus my gaze. It is a point that at that moment has the same value for me as a dim gleaming in the night toward which I must head before being able to see. Once I have arrived, the next light to reach, continually inventing the path to follow. Is this route perhaps the most interesting part of the action? I am like the spider that launches the line to the protuberance that seems more propitious, and then to another one it notices later, point by point, imposed on the canvas. Matisse often compared his work to that of a medium or an acrobat, setting it within the dynamic rationale of the duration, the gestation, and the variation, expressing the ambition to present a painting or drawing as the result of a process. Picasso, on the other hand, had for several years been working on a major graphic project that was the continuation of his engrisme. The suite Volard, commissioned in Flirty by the merchant of the same name, is a series of 100 prints made between the spring of 1933 and 1937. Owing to Volard's accidental death and the outbreak of the Second World War, this place with neither a specific order nor a title, inspired by the self-reflexive theme of the artist before his model and by the variations on Balzac's unknown masterpiece, did not appear on the market until 1950 and with great delay. Could Matisse have been familiar with that suite when he began working on Thème et Variation? In his memoir, Brassai suggests that Matisse probably was at least influenced by Picasso's scattered drawings. I quote, "The spontaneity, the obscure power of the hand beyond the control of the eyes, and even the brain preoccupied Matisse a great deal. He wanted to know what he could do when abandoned to its fate, cut off from the body, as it were. Perhaps Picasso's exercises played some role in this. The drawings made in about 1933, in the dark or with his eyes closed, in which the organs, eyes, nose, ears, lips, no longer occupied their usual place, were undoubtedly the source for the dismantled faces that appeared a few years later. One day in 1939, in his studio on Rue des Plantes, Matisse did a drawing for me, blindfolded. It was a face drawn with a piece of chalk. He executed it with a single line. In this very expressive portrait, the eyes, mouth, nose, and ears overlapped, as in Picasso's distorted faces. Jean-François Chevrier identified this approach to the body as a mental image in perpetual movement in the cultural and political context of the 30s, determining therein an open form of reaction to the totalitarian expressions, and I quote him. This dimension of permanent activity and change constitutes tracing as the writing of the body. Aragon describes the wall of Thème et Variation as definite images of the undefinable. There does not exist for the subconscious an ideal, definite image of the body. The undefinable contradicts the heroic and deathly fixation produced by fascist art. Thank you.